You're listening to the audio production of the Hard Good Audio Bible Studies by Lisa Whittle, published by Harper Christian Resources. The Audio Bible Studies series provides a unique audio learning experience. Unlike a traditional audiobook's direct narration of a book's text, the Hard Good includes high-quality live audio sessions from the author that cover important Bible-based topics. These sessions will reflect the ambiance of the unique recording locations, immersing the listener into the teaching. While not required for the audio experience, these studies are designed to partner with a coordinating study guide sold separately.
Do something with me, will you? Put your hand over your heart. Hold it there for just a minute. Can you feel that? Can you hear it? It's God saying to you with every single beat, I love you. You're still here, and I want to do a great work in and through you. Maybe you've been questioning that lately. Maybe your past keeps coming up, or you have a current struggle in a certain area, or maybe simply because life is hard right now, it's even harder to consider God using your life in any meaningful way. John 16:33 says this, in this world, there will be trouble. This is not an if statement, but a when statement. And then this most important part of the verse, the second part, but take heart, I've overcome the world. If you believe that, or you want to believe that, keep listening. I've got some important things to tell you. I'm Lisa Whittle, and I want to welcome you to the Hard Good Bible Study. This message has been a long time coming, and I'm ready to get started. You know how sometimes people say, I never saw that coming, when something significant happens in their life? I feel that. So much of my life, I didn't see coming. But I did see one thing coming in a way. Today. This day of filming a Bible study for the Hard Good. Now, I didn't necessarily know it would look like this, but I knew about 3 years ago that God showed me something through Scripture He wanted me to eventually share with you. I remember the entire scene. I was sitting in my favorite chair, spending time alone with the Lord. I happened to be in 1 Samuel chapter 9. I was reading about a man named Saul. Now, you probably heard about Saul. I had too. In fact, when you're a preacher's daughter, you went to Christian elementary, middle school, high school, Christian college, and then seminary. You have heard a lot about a lot of the stories and people in the Bible for years. Saul is someone I've always heard characterized as someone with a reputation for being kind of a bad guy, or at least not good in comparison to someone like David, his arch rival. But I never thought much more about it than that. Never studied his life any deeper to understand how he got to the point that he would hide in baggage or chase down David. What makes a man turn into that kind of man? Now listen, it's not that God didn't use Saul to do good things. Remember, Saul did do some good things. That day I was reading about him, I read about how he united tribes and prophesied as the Spirit came upon him. But here's what I also read in my Bible commentary that day. Though Saul served as the first king of Israel for 42 years, he never truly became God's man. 42 years. Saul served in a position that God once anointed and appointed him to, but he never truly became God's man. Now, how is that even possible? You might be wondering, what does it have to do with the Hard Good? What does it have to do with me or my life? I'm so glad you asked, because the answer is everything, actually. See, God's intention for all of us is that He would do a great work in and through us while we're here on earth. That we would become used by Him for a powerful kingdom purpose. Remember, this is always for the glorification of Him, not us, and in His strength, not ours. He breathed life into each of us, and it was for a reason beyond just making it through life. If we're still here, and the fact that we are listening and watching right now says we are, then that purpose remains. But we can inhibit God's plan by our unwillingness to sit with God through the uncomfortable process of transformation. A lot of us think that the reason we never get anywhere in life is because life is too hard. But the real reason is because when life gets hard, We keep bailing and never let God take us through the hard things. I understand. I have been a notorious bailer in my life. But this is our moment. This is our moment. To hold steady, to stand boldly, to remain and watch God finally do things with us and through us that we otherwise cannot do. Now, your next question may be, but what do I have to actually do to see that happen for me? Again, great question. We need to start by recognizing misleading messages about hard and redefine good according to the Word of God instead of our current culture. This is where we have to know the Word to recognize counterfeit messages. Counterfeit messages may be in the form of something very close to right and true. Listen, Satan doesn't mind using partial truth to sell us on a whole lie. The world tells us about hard. It says we can do hard things. Cheers us like a cheerleader with that positive message. And I love positive messages. But the problem is it leaves off the most important part. We can do hard things through Christ who gives us strength. Jesus is the only reason we can do hard things, my friend. Now, the world might say this sounds nitpicky, but it's crucial. It is the crux of the message. The humanistic riff off Philippians 4:13, I can do all things, is more than just an oversight on the part of culture. It's yet another way we rely on our own self-sufficiency. We cut God out of the equation. We do things ourselves. You might say, Lisa, we can do hard things. It's just a statement. It's no big deal. But that's how we become numb. We hear statements like this over and over again, and we become desensitized to them to where we don't recognize them as false or damaging in their almost truth. The root of this is also how Satan got in trouble, remember? Because he wanted to become equal with God. He wanted his ability to be equal with God's ability. So the statement isn't as innocent as it may seem. We can't produce in life what God can. It also isn't great for us to believe we can, because hard things without God are exhausting. They make us feel helpless at a certain point. Our strength wears out and we'll want to give up, even the strongest among us. At some point, pulling ourselves up by the bootstraps will not work anymore. And someone knows what I mean because your bootstraps have been way overworked. In this great redefining of the hard and the good, our job is to simply stay with God through the uncomfortable process of refinement. In other words, to take the heat as we become more in His image and less about ourselves. Choose not to walk away. Let God change you and chip away all that is not kingdom worthy. Stop running away. Saul's life is a picture of what you might have been able to see coming if you were paying attention to his life. He was jealous, reckless, angry, insecure. Even though we know from the Bible he was very attractive, very charismatic. He had all of these gifts. He didn't just become the kind of person overnight that hid in luggage or chased David down. He spent years developing into that person, or rather, never allowing God to change him out of it. He never sat in that uncomfortable process with God and let God work on those things in his heart, the things that would change him and make him truly kingdom usable, to where maybe the Bible commentary would instead say, he became God's man instead of he never truly did. Instead of allowing God to use hard moments to shape his character, he carried them with him year after year, situation after situation, to the end of his life. Did you know that we can get offended at our lives? That's where Saul landed. He was supremely offended at his life. It's true. Our circumstances often offend us, and because of this, we run, we turn, we bail on God's transformative process. Now, stay with me. A lot of us are in what I call a cycle of offense over something that has happened to us, so we refuse to see anything good that God wants to do next, or even concede that anything good has come from something hard. This denial results in us remaining stuck, often for years. The cycle of offense goes like this. There's a hard thing that happens. It results in anger or hurt, results in being offended, results in a blocked progression. We never get past this, and then another hard thing comes and we start all over again. Ask yourself this question at some point later on in the quiet when you're alone with Jesus. Am I offended by my life? And if so, when and where did it offend me? When we get offended by our life.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.